Thank you, Jamie. That's such a great way to start the show. I think it really speaks to what this event is all about. So thank you so much. Next up, we have Melissa Higgs. As a principal architect at HCMA Architecture and Design, Melissa Higgs creates innovative public buildings where communities come together. She believes that true collaboration and interdisciplinary design leads to spaces that support, encourage, and foster a range of social interactions. For Melissa, architecture has the power to improve the world and build human connections in small but profound ways, leaving a lasting positive impact. Alongside her work at HCMA, Melissa teaches at UBC's School of Architecture and Landscape Architecture, has been a member of AIBC's diverse membership group, and currently sits on the Policy Advisory Council for the Downtown Vancouver Business Improvement Association. Please welcome Melissa.
Thank you. Well, it might seem a bit risky to start a talk about design impact with a photograph of my kids, but it's actually even worse than that because I'm going to start by talking to you about math. So a few weeks ago, my son was doing his math homework at the kitchen counter, and he was taking a number and he was adding it to itself, starting with one, and he was adding the sum to itself and so on. And he looked at me and he said, "How long do you think it will take me to get to 1 billion? And I said, "I don't know, but let's try." And so we took out a piece of paper, and here it is. We, in less than half an hour, got from 1 to 1 billion. And that actually kind of blew my mind, because I thought it was going to take a lot longer. And I want you to kind of hold that math thought in your mind, and I'm going to tell you a story. And it's a story about where I grew up, which was a very, very small town, less than 100 people. And in that small town, we had three community buildings. One was a general store and a post office where the kids caught the bus in the morning. There was a church, of course, and there was a one-room community hall, so it had a stage. We hosted the odd terrible play and some bake sales, but most of the time it was closed. And there was a slide and a swing set, but not a lot of use from the kids at that playground. But what it did have was this amazing willow tree just behind the fence at the community center. It was like 6 stories tall, and in one big summer storm, it got hit by lightning, and that tree cracked right at the base. And it was one of the most amazing things that had happened to me and the rest of the kids in this community, because these kind of sweeping branches made a wall, and inside this wall were the most amazing spaces. There was kind of overlook and places to kind of see and be seen. And the really amazing, impactful thing about this willow tree was that it broke the rules. It changed the rules about who you could and couldn't play with at school. And it drew us like a magnet for the 2 weeks that it lasted. And I ask myself now, decades later as an architect, what if we took some of those basic principles about that willow tree and applied them to all of our design? Because in some ways, it was a truly socially inclusive space. It welcomed everybody, it was free to enter, and it was open 24 hours a day. So what if we designed all of our spaces like that? What kind of an impact could we have? And here's one of the things that motivated me to go to architecture school, the belief that architecture could change the world. And maybe there's some of you out there who believe this still. And I'm an optimist, and I certainly believe that architecture has the ability to make really profound change. But what I really believe now is that we need to work together and be cross-disciplinary to kind of achieve the sort of change that we need. So I think that the complex problems that we're facing both locally and globally require us to work together to kind of get the impact that we need. I mean, we quite literally need more hands and more minds at the table solving these difficult problems. And I think that in order for true interdisciplinary collaboration to work, you have to kind of earn your seat at the table based on what you know, but you have to know not quite enough about what the other disciplines know to prevent you from asking kind of the naive questions, because it's those naive questions that lead us to some really amazing places. And I want to share with you now a story about one of the journeys and the explorations that our firm is looking at in terms of interdisciplinary collaboration. And one of them is an artist-in-residence program. So a few years back, we started this idea, artist-in-residence, where we offered a small amount of money for artists to collaborate with us. And all we asked of them really was that they work in their own medium and that they be genuinely interested in learning from us and letting us learn from them. Alex Beam up next actually is one of our artists. But what I want to share with you tonight is the result of our collaboration we did with Heather Myers. And Heather is a dancer and a choreographer, and she came to us with the idea that dancers interpreted space and experienced space in a different way, and she wanted to explore that with us by choreographing a dance piece about one of our buildings. And the result was quite profound, and it changed how I looked at those spaces. But what I want to do now is talk more about math, because we want to continue to make those explorations, but we also want to find out how to measure the kind of impact that we want to have. And it's really hard to do. So as a firm, we're kind of struggling with that, and it's something that I'm very inspired by. And I'm going to show you now a kind of tongue-in-cheek equation here that one of our fabulous interns came up with, and we call it the underwear effect. And it was an exploration around the idea of shared laundry facilities in residential buildings, and there was nothing that bonded you together with somebody than as much as seeing them pull their underwear out of the dryer. And I mean, I'm joking, but I'm also serious. We have to find a way to, there's something really impactful about those design decisions that do build community. So I'm very lucky to work in a highly collaborative design firm, and I think all these different disciplines, they're really changing the way we do our work, and that's amazing. And I think they're also helping us with this struggle around finding metrics to kind of track our success. And so another project I want to share with you is a laneway activation that some of you might know. It's between Grandview, Granville and Hastings and Seymour and Pender. And we worked with the Downtown Vancouver Business Improvement Association to kind of transform this laneway into a space. And the results and the impact have been really beyond what we could have imagined. And quite quickly, actually, it became a bit of an Instagram favorite. And we see all of these incredible activities that we couldn't really have imagined happening in there. There's pickup basketball games. There's a wedding. There was a pop video filmed there. But I think most importantly, what we're seeing is that people are engaging with this space and engaging with each other in really kind of profound and meaningful ways. And that's what we want in an inclusive city spaces. So we did actually get to measure some of the metrics around this, and we tracked foot traffic before, and then we tracked foot traffic after in the lane, and we found that it nearly tripled, which is a really amazing. And then the other thing that makes me very happy is that we also tracked the amount of women using the alley before and after, and we saw that number went up by 50%. So these are the kind of metrics that I think are important in terms of convincing decision makers that design really does have an impact. It has an impact in our cities, it has an impact in our lives, and that it's really, really important. And then, of course, I want to get back to math again. And this is actually kind of a sketch version of maybe what that first or that second slide, that kind of what I would call the 1 to 1 billion slide. And it's just, there's kind of two key takeaways for me. The first is that we can maximize our social impact by amplifying what we are each capable of doing individually as designers. And instead of going linear to get to a billion, we need to go broader and deeper to get to a billion. And the second thing is that we can start really small and get somewhere amazing. So maybe it's a dance, maybe it's a laneway, maybe it's a community center, but next it's a whole city. And you know, what is our 1 billion? Maybe it's we solve homelessness in Vancouver. That would be pretty amazing. And I want to leave you with this challenge question. I want you to ask yourself what's possible, and then I want you to try and do it. And then I want you to ask the person beside you what's possible and see if you can get there faster together. Thank you.